Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to Surviving Survivor Series. This week, we will be taking a look at the unfortunate event known as the 2007 Survivor Series. And man, was this a hard time to watch wrestling. This was one of those times in life when just wrestling dragged. This was the time when I first started thinking about doing this show. 3 years before I actually started it. But I hadn't found anything that just really irked me quite as much as some of the stuff that Michael Cole did during the women's season of NXT. That's what got me started here. But let's take a look at the 2007 Survivor Series. Opening match was first time ever the ECW Championship was defended at the Survivor Series. CM Punk defending the championship against The Miz and John Morrison, who just became tag team champions a couple nights earlier. As far as the match goes, this was a very solid opener for this pay-per-view and showed promise for what could be a great pay-per-view. And I say showed promise, but that doesn't necessarily mean anything. As far as things go, Miz, Morrison, and CM Punk did exactly what they needed to do. They went out there and they started hot, they started fast. In the end, Punk winds up picking up the victory with the GTS over top The Miz 1-2-3 to retain the ECW Championship. I gave it a B-. Nice, fast-paced match. MVP interviewed by an unknown backstage interviewer. I really didn't know who she was. He's out to tell everyone that he's better than Matt Hardy and everyone else. And this was like right after he turned on Hardy, of course, because, you know, that was when they lost the tag team championships to Miz and Morrison. We then proceed to the 10 Divas tag team matchup, which was not Elimination Survivor Series style. It was just 5-on-5. And this is what began what I refer to, unfortunately, as the WWE's P-Break division, where every women's matchup, unfortunately, was time to go take a piss. This is when you got up, you walked away, you didn't care, there was nothing worth watching. And this matchup was relatively blandy-bland-blandiose. The most interesting thing about it was that Melina botches her entrance with her... right as, I think it was Taz was like, go, you know, selling it up so much great, and then, boom, she crotches herself on the apron, but she gets back up and does it again. Woo. As far as the match went, it was alright. In the end, Mickey James' team won. I really couldn't care. I gave the match a C. It was kind of bland. Speaking of bland, we go backstage to Randy Orton doing another bland, plodding, dragging on interview where he leaves 5 seconds between every few words. I don't know why Orton thought that it was a good idea to sell his stuff like that. And yes, Triple H did cut promos that way. But then at least with Triple H, you could pretend he was James Hetfield. Because he is the game. And it's still slightly more entertaining. Than Randy Orton. Yeah. This was the reason why I have a hard time giving a shit about Randy Orton now and then. Move on to the World Tag Team Championship match. Hardcore Holly and Cody Rhodes challenged the team of Lance Cade and Trevor Murdoch. Decent tag team matchup, couple good spots, but it wasn't really anything special. In the end, it wasn't anything worth remembering. I gave it a C. Because Matt Hardy was laid out, apparently now the Triple H's team is going to be coming in a person behind. And in the process of everything, Triple H and Kane have to remind us of the whole Katie Vick story. As they're pretty much talking about how Triple H has pretty much gone ahead and screwed over every member of his team. Which leads us on to the match in question. Mr. Kennedy, Finlay, Big Daddy V, MVP, and captained by Umaga, taking on the team of Kane, Rey Mysterio, Jeff Hardy, and the game. Triple H. As far as the match went, it was alright. It served the purpose of the stories and everything like that. Matt Hardy wasn't involved because Matt Hardy was injured. He was supposed to be on Triple H's team along with his brother Jeff. Triple H and Jeff Hardy survive. I gave the match a C+. It was alright. It's about what you expect. A little bit better. Only thing that came out of it was that Kennedy's microphone didn't work very well at the beginning. Backstage, we have Hornswoggle as he's worried about his match with the Great Khali. This is him while they apparently, this is right after the reveal that he is Vince McMahon's illegitimate bastard son. And Vince is giving a pep talk to Hornswoggle, talking to him about how he's a McMahon, and McMahon's always rise to the occasion and win. Then we get towards the match. Shane makes his way out. Then he introduces Vince. Then he announces out Hornswoggle McMahon. They take the time to lay out all the rules. This took way too long and was exceptionally boring. The most entertaining part of this matchup was Hornswoggle trying to kick the legs of Khali and Hornswoggle taking out Ranjan Singh. That's about it. You get the fans cheering for Shaquille O'Neal, who's sitting at ringside. Vince says he doesn't give a crap what they want. In the end, Hornswoggle pretty much gets hit once by Khali and gets laid out. Oh yeah, and Hornswoggle uses the green mist. Because leprechaun magic, motherfuckers. Finlay finally comes out and attacks Khali, and Hornswoggle gets disqualified because he used the shillelagh and attacked him. This match was a D+, but did we expect anything else from it? I could have given it a C for being exactly what we expected, but no. We don't reward for laziness, ladies and gentlemen. No, we don't. WWE Championship with the Super Kick Band, and if Randy Orton is disqualified, he loses the championship. Heartbreak Kid Shawn Michaels versus Randy Orton. Wow, what a concept. They had a pretty good back and forth matchup. I liked the way the story was told. I give Randy Orton a lot of crap, but when he's in there with the right wrestlers, he can tell a decent in-ring story. And when he works with the right people, he can sometimes actually be decent on the mic. I actually liked some of the work he was doing with Bray Wyatt. Too bad that's kind of in the crap hole, and he's still got a concussion and injured from Brock Lesnar. Thanks, Brock Lesnar. The fact is, when this matchup came down, we had the right ending is how it happened. That Shawn almost super kicked, almost got himself disqualified. Orton hits the RKO, picks up the win. I gave the match a B-. It was a well laid out story. And I found it interesting in the process that Shawn Michaels having to use so many different maneuvers, including, rather surprisingly, the crippler crossface just months after Chris Benoit. Only Shawn Michaels could get away with that. And Triple H. But pretty much only Shawn Michaels. We then get Jericho's code appearing on the screen, noting that it will be happening the next night on Raw. We didn't know it was Jericho, but we knew it was Jericho. You know. Hell in a Cell for the World Heavyweight Championship. The Undertaker versus Batista. This was the first time they introduced the modern-day Hell in a Cell cage, which slightly skinnier, but significantly taller. You got Taker breaking the door right off the bat, so way to take the rust right off of that warranty right out of the shop, Undertaker. As far as the match goes, it was brutal, it was bloody, and this is probably one of the last really brutally bloody matches you'll see. I keep saying that every week, but then again, I haven't watched next week's episode yet, so I don't know. I just remember in when it really got into the PG era was when they started stopping matches and stopping the blood. I think the first time I really noticed that was like Randy Orton versus Christian, I think it was, and it just dragged the match, and it just pissed off a lot of people. In the end, Edge was disguised as a cameraman, interferes, and lays out Undertaker. This is one of the last times you also see significantly painful, unprotected headshots with the chairs and weaponry because, you know, when it was realized that there was this much concussion issue, especially with Chris Benoit, it became the number one naughty no-no of the WWE. It shows that they didn't immediately learn the lessons of Chris Benoit, and probably because there was still a lot that was being discovered at that time. Score for Undertaker versus Batista inside the Hell in a Cell, I gave it a B. I enjoyed the matchup. I think it was a solid finish to the event. Final score for the 2007 Survivor Series was a squeaking C+, and it only gets that because the two main event matches really carried their main event caliber, and the opening contest did well. The rest of the card was shit. Frankly, if you had given those other three matches just a little bit longer or just had those three matches, this would have been a stellar pay-per-view and would have at least been worth watching. Next week, 2008 Survivor Series. Again, sorry, I haven't watched it yet. I'm just barely catching up with myself, so I don't remember what happened. But we'll check it out next week and enjoy. Feel free, as always, to comment, let me know what your thoughts are on the show, on Survivor Series. What did you think of the 2007 Survivor Series? Did you think it was shit? Did you think it was good? Do you think I was a little too harsh on certain things? Feel free to always comment, and please like, share, and subscribe. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and I will see you guys next week with more Royal Road as we continue to survive Survivor Series. See you there.